look at it or compare it or anything like that. Okay. All right, so can we get Mr. Sprinkle over to finish up his testimony?
Your Honor, Mr. Sprinkle, so as I explained before, I called Mr. Sprinkle when we intended to call Mr. Zachary. Mr. Sprinkle's testimony, and in order to avoid him being called twice, we were putting in the interview of Mr. Zachary, given his continued pronouncements regarding his health concerns and other considerations. We were going to call Detective Gaither to simply get in the interview regarding Mr. Zachary. Mr. Sprinkle's investigation, if you will deal with some of the information that comes from Mr. Zachary's interview. And rather than asking the court to call Mr. Sprinkle twice.
Well, we're calling lots of witnesses twice, or you are calling lots of witnesses twice, so.
Your Honor, I'd ask the court's permission, since we do have Detective Gaither here, to allow us to put in Mr. Zachary's interview and to allow us to proceed after Detective Gaither with.
And what is Detective Gaither just going to be introducing the interviews?
She's going to be introducing the interviews. Primarily, that is the reason that we have her. She also confirmed, though Mr. Zachary was able to confirm, some information about his phone number, another phone number. I told her that I don't expect to keep her very long. I don't expect her to be more than today, frankly. And yeah, that's it. And the other matter that I wanted to broach with the court simply dealt with the concerns that the court had that we broached briefly regarding some of the cross-examination testimony and some of the information in the interview with Mr. Zachary on the 5th of August, 2015 that we believe has addressed some of the concerns that the court had regarding.
I'm sorry, but I don't know what you're talking about.
So in my email to the court, I said that there were some matters that we would ask permission to address prior to claiming the interview. some of the portions of the interview that defense requested redacted, the court said that it needed sometimes foundational information before I went ahead and.
Okay, and I think that Ms. Pursefield responded to everybody that we're not going to address that this morning before, and we know that the jury is going to be here and ready to go at 9, and I don't think there should be time to address all of that in the 5 minutes before the jury is here. Do you?
Well, there's one that I think we can. It's the first one that we have listed.
Okay. Well, anyway, that is what I said we would address either at lunch or at the end of the day, correct? All right. And so for that reason as well, we're not really ready for Detective Gaither's testimony. So go ahead and call Mr. Sprinkle over and let's pick up with him, because we can't, if we need to do the whatever is or is not going to come in the interviews, and it's different from what we had already made determination about, and we left some things for determination. We have to figure that out during the lunch break. So,
yes, Your Honor. Will the court permit me to step out and make that phone call?
Yes, please.
And also, Your Honor, so will the court be permitting me or allowing me to bring Mr. Sprinkle back after we get into the testimony?
I mean, it seems to me like that's been kind of the way this case has gone, is that people get called back 2 and 3 times. So sure, you can do that with him too. Okay.
of returns, I'd just like to briefly address something. Thank you.
to address something?
Yeah, just briefly, Your Honor, and I'm not sure when the state plans on using this, but on the 27th of September, so what, 3 days ago, we got a Dropbox link with additional crime scene photos from a 2019 case, a 2014 case, and a 2015 case. These hadn't previously been provided.
Of what?
Well, I think you'd have to ask maybe Mr. Atkins or the state. One of them relates to, I just have APD case numbers. I think they could give you more detail.
Okay.
My main point being these should have been provided in December of 22 at the latest. So I don't know why we're just receiving these now. And as seems to be my role in the case, I'm here to once again complain about late discovery, Your Honor.
Ms. Love?
Your Honor, I'd ask the court, since that is not something that will be broached this week at all, that the court allow us to address the matter when I have those files in front of me that Mr. Weinstein
has. How about you get those files at lunch? Seems to me like we're going to have a lot to talk about over lunch.
We can do that, Your Honor. And also, I will say that those are, to the extent that, of course, I will look back and make sure that they were not previously provided, but to the extent that they were not, the crime scene information that we have turned over is a direct result of matters and witnesses that we have added back because of the objections that have been made. And the CAD reports, I believe, have already been admitted as evidence. So there is nothing about the photographs that would create any delay or prejudice or anything of that matter, but I'll address it at lunch.
What were the dates?
These are cases from, according to what Mr. Atkins sent, 2019, 2014, and 2015, Your Honor. And Mr. Atkins, in an email to me on that same date, the 27th, indicated to me that these had not previously been provided to us. So we can discuss it at lunch as the court wishes, Your Honor.
Okay. All right. Ms. Love, in your Sunday 6 p.m. email, you said that you were going to forward later in the evening to counsel and the court the portions of Mr. Zachary's interview that you were seeking reconsideration of based or because of, I guess, the way he testified. I'm not in receipt of that forward. Did you ever forward what the actual portions are?
Your Honor, I think, no, I forwarded the transcript, the corrected transcript that I was seeking.
But you didn't forward the portions that you had that either I had ruled out or you had agreed would be out?
I did not forward those. There were...
And yeah, that's what you expected everybody to argue this morning without even knowing what those were. Could you please forward those at your earliest convenience so that we will know by lunchtime what it is that we're talking about?
Absolutely.
Excuse me. I didn't receive the transcript last night.
Well, she's agreed that she's not going to be using the transcript because nobody's had a chance to look at it. So
you
don't need to worry about that.
Thank you, Your Honor.
But I don't know if somebody's going to be over here to assist you later in the morning, but as soon as somebody gets here, you need to get that taken care of. Okay.
Yes, Your Honor.
All right. So is Mr. Sprinkle out there ready?
He said that he needed 10 minutes from the time that I reached him. So
tell him, text him now and tell him he needs to get over here right now.
He is, Your Honor. He is coming. He
text
literally
him anyway and say, the 10 minutes, he can't have any more time. He needs to stop what he's doing right now and come on. Because we have the jury waiting.
Yes, Your Honor.
And then while we wait, I guess you can go ahead and forward us those portions of the interview that you think need reconsideration, since we'll just be sitting here doing nothing otherwise?
Yes, Your Honor.
Thank you.
Oh, look, here's Mr. Sprinkle.
No, you may not. Let's get the jury in. Mr. Sprinkle, let's see.
Yes, sir.
All right, so jurors.
Thank you. Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. I hope that you enjoyed your unexpected four-day weekend. I hope that nobody is too poor, badly impacted by the storm that swept through. And we are ready to proceed. And we're picking up with Mr. Sprinkle, who was on the stand, early last week, maybe. But anyway, go ahead, Ms. Lowe.
Thank you, Your Honor. And good morning, DDA Sprinkle. How are you?
Very well. How are you?
I'm good. Thank you. So when we last left off, you were explaining to the jury regarding the investigation into the murder of Donovan Thomas, the additional steps that you took in determining what to do with the file once you received it from the Atlanta Police Department.
Right.
All right. And you had explained that there were jail calls that you were able to listen to make certain determinations regarding information that was a part of the file.
Can y'all hear her? Okay. Everybody can hear her? Okay. Richard, look, tell them what you can.
Would you rather, okay, even at the podium?
I don't know. It just seems, if everybody can hear her, that's fine. It just didn't seem as loud. Okay. Go ahead.
I can write it down.
Maybe while he's answering, you can hook it up.
I don't think I can do both of those. This is a difficult contraption. I'll talk into the microphone.
Okay.
All right. So, Mr. Sprinkle, with respect to Spencer Wright, or the person that Detective Thorpe spoke to before taking out the warrants, and the jail call that you listened to.
Correct.
Is my memory correct that you said that Detective Investigator David White was the person who then spoke with or went out and reached out to the person that Mr. Wright called from the Atlanta City Jail?
That is correct.
And the information that you received or that you were able to gain from that phone call made from the Atlanta City Jail, what impact did it have on your investigation into the murder of Donovan Thomas?
It corroborated what I already believed, which was that Spencer Wright, who initially provided the name of Nicholas Robb.
I'm going to object to that testimony as to relevance. His belief is not relevant.
Sustained.
So as a result of the information that you got from that phone call, with respect to information that would assist you further in the investigation, what did you do after you listened to the phone call and had Detective White speak to Mr. Smalls?
Well, I spoke with Detective White. Well, broadly, I just embarked on the investigation of the murder of Donovan Thomas, because at that point I was essentially without sufficient evidence.
Okay.
I can no longer rely on that statement.
All right. Now, at the time that you got the file, had Kenneth Copeland already been interviewed?
He had been.
All right. And when you reviewed that, those interviews of Kenneth Copeland, did you endeavor to speak with him anymore, or did you gain more information from the interviews themselves that assisted you in your investigation?
Well, as the investigation, as the months went by, I did desire to speak with Kenneth Copeland, but that did not happen. He wasn't willing to speak with me.
How many of his interviews did you have at your disposal?
Well, I believe there were three. There was one in particular from June of 2015.
That was the 9-hour interview?
That would be the 9-hour one, yes. Right.
Did you set out to corroborate anything that you found? I'm sorry.
Sustained.
Yeah, I didn't hear the objections to that.
Leading.
Oh, okay. With respect to the Kenneth Copeland interview, did you take it at face value, everything that you heard in the interviews, or did you do anything to decide how you would treat the information?
Well, on listening to the interview and taking notes, I endeavored to corroborate as much of his statement as I could.
Did that involve listening to other interviews and jail calls as well?
Yes.
Would you tell the jury what other interviews you listened to without talking about what was said in the interviews themselves?
Sure. Well, there was the interview of Demekeen Garlington. There was an interview of Quindarius Zachary. And when I say there was an interview, I'm contemplating in my mind that there was only the one, but it is possible there were perhaps two or even three interviews, but I'm only recalling off the top. They may have all just run together as I listened to them. But as far as I know, there was at least one interview of everybody that I'm mentioning right now.
Okay. And with respect to Quindarius Zachary, did you take part in a 2017 proffer of Quindarius Zachary or include that as a part of your file?
I did, and it was recorded. I have it on a desk over here as well.
All right. And did you also listen to the August 2015 interview of Mr. Zachary?
I believe so. Yes, that would be the one.
Would you tell the jury what cell phone records or what cell phone numbers you found of interest after listening to the interviews?
Well, there would probably be a few, but I do, and I can't recall at the top of my head what specific cell phone numbers were mentioned during each interview. For example, depending on the interview, the party may have identified their own cell phone number or somebody else's cell phone number. But the numbers that were primarily of interest to me were those for which Detective Tyrone Dennis obtained phone records.
Mm-hmm.
The numbers that he obtained, I believe, were primarily, if not exclusively, from either A, the interviews that he conducted, or B, from cell phones that he found during the course of his investigation. He was able to forensically analyze and extract the number therefrom.
Now, you mentioned last time you were on the stand getting the videos or the surveillance videos enhanced, the ones from the Texaco and the barbershop.
Yes.
Was there any other surveillance footage that you were able to obtain that was not a part of the original file that Mr. Detective Thorpe gave to you? Is the surveillance footage from the Texaco and the barbershop the surveillance footage that you used in making your decisions about what to look for next in this case?
From what I recall, I was primarily, if not exclusively, focused on the surveillance footage from the Texaco and the barbershop.
Okay. Who had you listened to the interviews from by the time that you did go into and look at the surveillance footage from the Texaco and from the barbershop? Or did you do that first?
Well, so I watched the surveillance footage many times. I'm sure I listened to while I was watching the interviews, I watched various parts of the footage. After I watched the interviews, I watched various parts of the footage. It wasn't as regimented as I had like a checklist where I watched the videos and then I watched the interviews. And I would keep revisiting things as I went through the case file.
Other than looking for someone in a particular place, like a park bench in the surveillance footage, what was it that the surveillance footage was able to give to you that you found of value in this investigation?
Well,
I'm going to object to the form of the question. What he found the value is not relevant, and I would ask that...
I can rephrase.
Okay, thank you.
What from the surveillance footage were you able to utilize in furthering your investigation?
Well, first of all, it marked the time, the exact time of the homicide, which broadly is just very important because it allows me to establish a time.
Again, to the testimony, what he found to be important is not relevant. I'd ask that be struck.
Your Honor, I ask permission to respond. With respect to what DDA Sprinkle did in gaining information about this homicide, as with any other witness, we'd ask that the court allow him to give the jury insight into how he gained the information that he got and made the decisions that he made.
Okay, let's just stick to the facts without value judgments. Go ahead.
Okay. After you were able to get phone records, listen to the interviews, were you personally or your investigator able to obtain social media records?
Yes.
How did you decide which social media records in this case you needed to look at?
Again, objection, how and why is not relevant. What he obtained is relevant.
Your Honor, how and why?
Overruled.
Thank you.
Well, I was focused on the social media of the parties that were of interest, either persons of interest, maybe witnesses, just as much. Whenever a name came up, I endeavored to find their social media, regardless of whether or not I actually thought that they were directly involved in the homicide. Perhaps there'd be something on their social media that would shed some light or illuminate something for me.
Now, did you ever look at the social media of a Quindary Zach?
I do, yes. I recall looking at his social media, yes.
Do you recall what his handle or handles were for various social media platforms?
Not off the top of my head, no.
But looking at your report, refresh your memory?
Yes.
Would you please look at your report?
Yes, and that's what's on the laptop in front of me, incidentally.
Okay.
Yeah. I just have it so I can do word searches.
All right.
I mean, I know he went by the moniker Little D.
Okay.
Yeah, I mean, unless you can point me to it, I don't know that I actually put a screenshot or an image from Mr. Zachary's, any of his social media in my report.
Okay. I'm going to show you what has been marked as Space Exhibit 360 Yankee. Speaking of social media, 360 Yankee through 363 Yankee. At what point did you begin looking for social media photos related to Javaris Bradford?
That would have been, again, I don't know the specific date. But
I don't mean the date. I mean, what was your attention turned to Javaris Bradford?
Mr. Bradford caught my interest after, because as I said, I already had phone records belonging to various parties. These were phone records that I think were primarily, if not exclusively, obtained by investigator Tyrone Dennis. He caught my interest after I saw his number in a number and his number being 404-957-8008. His number I found in the phone records of Quindary Zachary, Demise McMullen, Kenneth Copeland, and Calvin Treadwell, meaning that I called detail records for those four people. And as I looked through them, I found that in close temporal proximity to the homicide, or maybe not, when I say close temporal proximity, it could be like a day or two within a day or two of the homicide, not necessarily within like 10 minutes. But I saw that he was that number, and I didn't know whose number it was when I first saw it, was a common number between them. In addition to that, when I ran it through the Fulton County Jail inmate call database, I found that another person who was an associate of those four people called that number, and that'd be Martinez Arnold. Martinez Arnold, a.k.a. Duke, was an inmate at the Fulton County Jail. So I ran 404-957-8008, which are 404-957-8008 through the Fulton County Jail's inmate call database, and I found two calls, I believe, that were placed from Martinez Arnold on the night of the homicide. And I think the first one was at 8:18 p.m., which was an hour after the murder. And so after I listened to those calls, I wanted to know a little bit more about Mr. Javaris Bradford. And as part of that process, I found his Instagram page.
I'm going to show you now what's been marked as 360 and provided to the Space Exhibit 360 Yankee.
I'm sorry, can I be
feel like I asked y'all to share exhibits that you were going to use with witnesses prior to using them with the witnesses. Is that not happening?
I believe that this has been shared for quite a while. Additionally, I will show to you 363 Yankee and provide to you on 363 Yankee. Do you recognize what has been labeled 360 Yankee?
Thank you.
361 Yankee, 362 Yankee, and 363 Yankee.
I recognize these, yes.
How do you recognize them?
These were, I found Mr. Bradford's Instagram page. The moniker that he went by on said Instagram page was I'm, that is spelled I'm underscore living, L-I-V-I-N-G underscore great. When I found a picture, or a post being a picture, sometimes with text accompanying it, although on these four pictures, it doesn't appear that Mr. Bradford actually posted any text along with the pictures, so those pictures, I screenshotted them. And these were the screenshots that I actually took as I viewed Mr. Bradford's Instagram page, the content of which was visible to the public.
Okay. And are those fair and accurate representations of the pictures depicted on the pages that you were looking at for Mr. Bradford?
They are, yes, they're printouts of the digital images that I captured, yes.
The state tender states exhibit 360, 361, 362, and 363 Yankee.
Those are admitted.
Thank you. Now, looking at 360 Yankee, would you tell the jury what they're looking at in 360 Yankee and what relevance it had to what you did after you got these social media posts?
360 Yankee depicts Javaris Bradford standing behind a Pontiac Bonneville, a gray in color Pontiac Bonneville. And I want to make sure, I think it's a 2002 Pontiac Bonneville. I want to get that right, so I'm refreshing my recollection. But I'm pretty sure it's a 2002 Pontiac Bonneville. But anyway, it's a gray in color Pontiac Bonneville. And the reason why that caught my interest is because there was actually several photos that I found that depicted him alongside a Pontiac Bonneville, and that caught my interest because it let me know that that was probably the car that he could be found in.
Why were you interested in a gray Pontiac Bonneville at the time that you saw these images on Mr. Bradford's page?
Well, at the time I saw these images, I wasn't.
Okay.
I mean, not really.
What did you see or hear, without getting into what anyone said, that caused you to take interest in these photographs? If it was an interview, he does not have to say what that person said. It doesn't call.
Well, I can say this. I looked at the surveillance footage, and I knew that there was some kind of type of gray car or cars that were involved. So gray car in general would have caught my interest. And when I say surveillance footage, I'm referring to the surveillance footage from the cameras that were mounted on 330 McDaniel Street, that being the barbershop in the parking lot which Donovan Thomas stood at the time that he was shot and killed. But then there was other surveillance footage from the Texaco station. And so to be clear, just so we're clear as to how the process went, when I first found these images, I was kind of generally interested. I said, oh, a gray vehicle. Okay, a gray sedan. But then as I went back and I reviewed the surveillance footage from the Texaco station yet again, I became considerably more interested in these images because I saw a gray Pontiac Bonneville on that footage in close temporal proximity to the homicide. And because that Texaco station was in close spatial proximity to the barbershop, that particularly caught my interest.
When you said you went out and looked at the scene, were you able to determine and explain to the jury how far the Texaco that you were looking at, the images on the Texaco that you were looking at, were from the barbershop at 330 McDaniel Street?
It was about 100 yards.
And would that extend beyond the doors of this courtroom, out to the elevator or something a little bit different?
It would be from about where I sit right now. Mm-hmm. Probably about twice the distance from where I sit right now to the elevator. So from here to the elevator, double that.
All right. Now, when you were out there, was there a line of sight from where you were looking at on the Texaco footage to the front of 330 McDaniel Street?
Yes.
Did you notice whether there were any street lamps or any kind of lighting out there as well?
There were. I don't recall if they were working.
Okay. Now, after you looked at this Texaco surveillance footage, did you only look at around the time of the murder? In other words, if the murder happened at 7:22 p.m., did you only look at 7:22 p.m. and a few minutes before and a few minutes after?
No, I looked, I believe the footage from the Texaco that was of interest to me actually started at 6:38 p.m.
Would you tell the jury why or what it was about 6:38 p.m. that had any significance?
Objection as to relevance.
Your Honor, I would ask that.
Overruled. Go ahead.
As specific, well, it was actually 6:41 p.m. having a look at my office, so it's about 3 minutes after that. Well, a 2002 Pontiac Bonneville that looked identical to the one that appeared on Mr. Bradford's Instagram page pulled up to a gas pump at that gas station.
All right. Do you remember which gas pump? In other words, was it the one furthest from 330 McDaniel, in the middle, or closest to 330 McDaniel?
It was an inside gas pump. It was in the like bank of gas pumps that would have been closest to 330 McDaniel, but the vehicle wasn't utilizing the pump that would put it in the absolute closest spatial proximity to 330 McDaniel, if that makes sense.
It does. Now, when you say the vehicle wasn't using the pump, did the vehicle use either pump at that gas station for the entire time that the vehicle sat at the pump?
No, I don't believe that anybody ever gassed up the car, if that's what you're asking. I don't believe anybody, I mean, obviously the whole thing's on video, but I do not remember anybody using the pump. I'm quite sure nobody actually fueled up the car while it was parked there at the pump.
At any time while you were looking at it, were you able to see individuals get out of or get into the Pontiac?
But on, I would object as to relevance, also as the best evidence. The video has been introduced. Thank you.
Did, Your Honor, may I ask the witness whether or not once he looked at it and saw whatever he saw?
Well, you can go ahead and
thank you.
Ask that, and I'll see if it's...
Did you recognize any persons that got, not from knowing them personally, but did you recognize any persons getting into or out of that Pontiac?
Objection as to relevance. The jury can make their own determination from the evidence that's already been admitted.
Sustained.
That you looked into further. Did you further look into anyone that you saw getting into or out of that Pontiac?
Well, yes.
Who would you tell the jury about one person that you saw getting into and out of that Pontiac?
I'm going to object. Same question.
Wait, ask the question again.
Would you tell the jury about one such person that you saw?
Sustained.
Did you see Diamante Kendrick getting out of the Pontiac?
I did.
Objection.
Sustained.
Move to strike, Your Honor.
It'll be stricken.
Who did you see getting out of the Pontiac?
I'm going to object. It's the same
question.
Sustained.
Your Honor. Yes. Would the court allow me to either approach and explain or allow the state to get information we believe will be made valuable to the jury at a later time? In other words, would the court please conditionally allow us?
Thank you.
watched the Pontiac at the gas station.
And incidentally, on looking at my report, it's a 2001 Pontiac Bonneville, according to my notes.
Thank you. After you saw that 2001 Pontiac Bonneville at the gas pump, did you see, can you tell the jury who it was you believed that you saw getting into and out of the vehicle based on the information you had at the time?
Well, there were multiple occupants of the vehicle, but I believe you're referring to Diamante Kendrick.
Okay. And what did you do once you saw Diamante Kendrick? Did you just see him or look at or observe him getting out of the vehicle, or did you do something else with that information?
Well, I wanted to speak with the people, the other people that were with him in that Pontiac Bonneville and another vehicle that appeared in the frame at some point.
Okay. Now, when you say the people that were with him, did you ever, were you ever able to make a decision about who you believed the people were that were with him in the Bonneville?
I eventually determined who they were and I spoke with them.
Okay. Did you only look at the inside or the outside rather of the Texaco station footage while you were reviewing this file to make decisions about the next step?
No, there was footage from the interior as well, the convenience store that was adjacent to the gas pumps.
Mm-hmm.
I looked at that too.
And were you able to get closer up pictures of anyone inside that gas station?
Yes.
Right. Now, did you find the person that you believed to be in that, getting out of that Bonneville, did you find that person's image on social media sites or in any other place that informed your next steps in the investigation?
Yes.
All right. So the person you believed to be Diamante Kendrick, what did you do once you believed it was Diamante Kendrick that you were looking at?
Well, I continued to watch the video, obviously, but I also, as I stated, endeavored to identify the other people. I mean, as you could probably determine by now, I thought there was an excellent chance that Javaris Bradford was also in the Bonneville.
Objection to his opinion.
All right.
Overruled.
Okay. And with respect to Javaris Bradford and Diamante Kendrick, was there anything about their actions while they were at that gas pump? Was there anything about their actions while they were at that gas pump? Specifically, you mentioned another vehicle.
Well, there were a couple of vehicles. And one, they were parked at that gas pump for a good long while, for over 30 minutes.
I can't believe the question calls for that.
So is it, oh, okay. You may continue. You said that.
What was the question now?
With respect to Mr. Bradford, you said that, and Mr. Kendrick, you said something about the length of time that they were at the gas station, at the gas pump.
Right. So they were there, the vehicle, the Bonneville's parked there from 6:41 p.m. to 7:17 p.m.
Mm-hmm.
At 7:17 p.m. it pulled off simultaneously with another vehicle with whom one of the occupants of the Bonneville.
Who was it that you believed you saw the other vehicle that pulled off simultaneously?
I'm gonna object, same objection as previously.
What did you say? Same objection as previous? Is that what you said?
Yes, in regards to his opinion of who he saw and best evidence also.
Your Honor, my question is, I hadn't finished it, but my question was with respect to the vehicle that he saw driving off simultaneously, what informed the next step in his investigation in terms of what?
Okay, you may ask that question.
What about the interaction between the people in the Bonneville and the people in the vehicle that pulled off simultaneously with the Bonneville informed the next steps in your investigation?
Well, one of the occupants of the Bonneville ran up to the other vehicle and had a conversation for about 30 seconds with the driver. That said occupant then ran back to the Bonneville, boarded the driver's seat of the Bonneville, and the two cars left simultaneously. And this was within 5 minutes of the drive-by shooting next door at 330 McDaniel Street.
Okay.
Did you do anything to determine what vehicle it was that drove off simultaneously with the Bonneville you believe to be occupied by Diamante Kendrick?
Yes, I just looked at the video. It was clear enough. I could tell what kind of vehicle it was.
All right. Did you do anything to obtain any records, registration, or anything else as it related to the vehicle that pulled off simultaneously with the Bonneville that you believe Mr. Diamante Kendrick occupied?
Yes, I sent a subpoena to various rental car companies to include Hertz.
Why did you send a subpoena to various rental car companies?
Because as I reviewed the file, there was information contained therein that one of the parties of interest rented the vehicle that was utilized.
Okay. Were you able immediately to obtain any records of interest as related to the vehicle that pulled off simultaneously with Bonneville?
I did.
What was it that you were able to obtain?
A woman named Carolyn Fry worked for Hertz. Apparently their custodian of records emailed me documents that were responsive to my subpoena.
Okay. And what person did the documents that you received, what person did they relate to?
They related to Jeffrey Williams.
Okay. Once you got these documents from Ms. Fry, did you do anything to further look into them?
Well, I sought to obtain identify the location of the vehicle that was of interest to me, that being an Infiniti.
And what did you do to determine the location of that vehicle?
I believe I asked David White to just run the current owner information. It turned out it was owned by somebody in Mississippi. It's but rental car companies don't keep their cars for very long. It's since been sold.
Did you speak to people at Hertz to determine any interactions they may have had with the person who rented the vehicle?
I did not, no.
Did your investigator or someone on your team?
Investigator White did, and I believe he was also with a detective or detectives from the Atlanta Police Department at the time.
Okay. Once you got information about the vehicle that pulled off simultaneously, would you tell the jury if any other vehicle furthered your investigation into this matter?
Well, there was, in addition to the vehicle that Infiniti from Hertz, there was a 2009 Volkswagen CC that also pulled up near the 2001 Pontiac Bonneville. And a occupant of that vehicle exited the Volkswagen CC and boarded the Bonneville. So I was eventually able to determine who the two people in the Volkswagen CC were as well.
You believe them to be? Go ahead.
Well, yes. Who I believe them to be, yes.
And were you able to in any way confirm their identities?
Yes, because I talked to them.
Okay. Once you spoke to the people who were in the Volkswagen, and once you determined who rented the vehicle that pulled off simultaneously with the Bonneville, what step did you take to gain more information into the solving the, or determining who's
responsible? Objection to the characterization of solving.
She refers.
You may answer.
Well, I tracked down those people that I first believed to be on the footage, and then I interviewed them.
Okay. Now, on scene at that gas station, did you ever see anyone that you believed to be Kenneth Copeland?
No.
Okay. And did you ever see, as it relates to either of those vehicles in that footage, anyone that you believe to be Kenneth Copeland?
No, I did not see anybody that I believe to be Kenneth Copeland.
Were you able to obtain and review phone records for Kenneth Copeland?
I did.
All right. And what number did you review the records for?
Well, I'm going to have to, if I may, refresh my recollection on that.
Please do, and just let me know when you've refreshed your memory.
There we go. 678. 278-5991.
Did you obtain phone records for anyone related to Kenneth Copeland in order to assist in your investigation? And I'll be specific. Did you ever obtain any information regarding either a Deshaun Quarterman or a Rontrez Brock?
Probably. I probably subpoenaed subscriber. I definitely know those names.
Mm-hmm.
And I definitely remember identifying their phone numbers.
Okay.
And and if there's records in the file, then that means I sent a subpoena. I don't believe I got search warrants for those numbers. I don't think I had probable cause, but I was at least able to obtain, you know, subscriber information and call detail reports.
Now, did you speak with anyone, or did you learn of anyone by the name of Sammy Davis during your time looking into this case?
I did.
Now, was that person already named in the file that you received from Detective Thorpe?
No.
How was it that you learned of the name Sammy Davis in this investigation?
So, I believe it was on September 26, 2016, I met with Mr. Donovan Thomas's mother.
With that, go ahead.
And she mentioned that,
Sustained. Did you get information from Donovan Thomas's mother that led you to Mr. Davis?
Yes.
After speaking with Donovan Thomas's mother, did you see anything on the news media or television that was of interest to you?
There was some news footage.
Hearsay.
Avoid hearsay in your response, please. I don't know if he's going to say it that way or not. Go ahead.
You can go ahead and answer without.
Yes.
What did you see? Did you see footage of people being interviewed after the murder of Diamond Thomas?
Yes.
All right. And were these people on scene the same night, or was this information that you viewed from?
Objection to the leading question.
Sustained.
What time in relation to the murder were these people being interviewed? By time, I do mean date-wise. Was it months after, close in time, temporally?
As far as I know, after the murder that night.
That same night?
Yes.
Okay. And who was it that you were looking at in this interview? What was the name of the person, if you recall?
No, that I don't recall.
Okay. Was this person in any way able to give you information that led you to find Mr. Davis?
I never talked to this person.
Was the information that you saw on the television instructive in determining Mr. Davis as a person of interest?
I don't know. I don't think so. That's not how I identified who Mr. Davis was. The news footage isn't how I identified him.
How did you go about finding Mr. Davis?
Well, I knew enough about them that I could reference just public records. Mm-hmm. And I don't really recall exactly how I did it. I just remember that I knew enough about this person's life. Mm-hmm. That I was able to look at public records and eventually figure out get the name of Sammy Davis and the date of birth. And then I was able to find him and interview him, and he confirmed.
Hold on, don't say what he said. You were able to interview him?
Yes.
All right. Now, once you interviewed Mr. Davis, at that time, did you have other phone numbers that were of interest in your investigation?
There were many phone numbers that were of interest in my investigation.
Were there any that you used in your investigation more than others?
Well, yeah, I'm sure there were numbers that were more interesting to me than others. Yes.
Specifically, did you find a number, or did you locate a number you believe to be associated with the demise McMullen?
I did.
What number was that?
Hold on, I'll have to refresh my memory on that. There we go. That number was 470.
No, I'm actually going to object to that testimony. Any information that you received from hearsay would be inadmissible.
From what would be?
Hearsay.
Your Honor, I'm
sustained.
I'm actually asking not whether it was. I asked him whether or not he found the number that he believed to be associated with this person.
I'll be hearsay, Your Honor.
It's not talking about what anyone else said. He hasn't even gotten into other things that he did to look into that number.
To the extent that he received that information from someone else, and to the extent that it's being offered for the truth of the matter service, specifically that number belongs to a certain person, that would be hearsay.
It is the
sustained.
Your Honor. All right. Did you look into observe and review phone records for phone number 504-975-3904?
I did.
What about phone number 504-346-9596?
Yes.
And 404-957-8008 that you talked about previously, was that another number that assisted more than others in this investigation?
It did.
Did you look at and review records for 678-542-3145?
Yo, yes.
And what about 470-262-2643?
Yes.
Now, were you able to review any other case files to get information that aided you in the investigation of the Donovan Thomas murder? In other words, were there other incidents that you looked into obtaining information from?
Yes.
What incidents were those?
There were several.
And confrontation clause?
I don't know whether that's going to be the case or not.
I'm not asking for anything that anyone said. I'm asking about other incidents that he reviewed.
I know what you're asking. I don't know how it's going to be answered. We need to avoid any confrontation clause violations or hearsay, but can't rule on that without.
Can you tell the jury the location of other incidents that you looked into?
Well, there were several.
Your Honor, I'm going to object. Course of conduct, irrelevant.
Your Honor, I believe.
You know what? Let's take our morning break right now. Mr. Sprinkle, can you step out?
Yes.
So I'm unclear where you're trying to go with this, which is why I'm not sure if those are valid objections or not.
Your Honor, as it relates to the other incidents that DDA Sprinkle obtained information relevant to this investigation, there were several, and I think that the jury has heard evidence of many of them, and the information that he got from those other case files and how he used it in this particular case, we believe is very relevant.
What do you expect his answer to be? What other case files? The alleged retaliatory back and forth that the state's theory has led to this? Or what? I mean, I don't know.
So, the state's theory is not that the back and forth, retaliatory back and forth.
Just answer what it is that you think that is going to be the other incidents.
Your Honor, the Dexter Montgomery incident. The Adele Drive incident. Incidents that involved Mr. Copeland. And the information that he was able to obtain and how he used that information.
All right, and what are the objections?
All right, so the objection is relevance. The objection is that it explains his course of conduct, which is not necessary, not relevant. I think the predecessor court heard at length the information about Dexter Montgomery. Several witnesses were called, detectives, investigators, witnesses from the prison system. And so the jury has heard that evidence before. Mm-hmm. They have heard the evidence about the Adele Drive shooting, both from officers who have come before the court and testified about it, as well as individuals who were there at the location. They have heard from Mr. Copeland for a long time, and both videos of him, detectives testifying about him previously, officers testifying about him previously. All of this information has been put in front of this jury previously. There's no relevance to Mr. Sprinkle at this point saying, again, regurgitating all of those and saying why they were important to him or important to the investigation. What importance they have, ultimately, they can argue in closing, but the jury's already before the jury. And so if I did not say that this evidence would be cumulative, I'll add that as well, but for the most part, it is irrelevant, and his course of conduct and why he found it to be important is not relevant to this jury.
Your Honor, may I respond?
Go ahead.
To the extent that what DDA Sprinkle did and why he did it is irrelevant, we would ask that the court not allow the inquiry into why any other witness, officer, investigator did what they did as well. We believe that it allows the jury to assess what happened during this case, assess the motives, the reasons why steps were taken, and to rebut the inference that the defendants are attempting to cause the jury to draw that somehow or another anyone in this particular case was targeted.
All right, I'm overruling the relevance objection and the cumulative objection, so he can say, you know, I also looked at XYZ file and then move on from there. And Mr. Sharp, what was your...
I was a little slow on the trigger, but I was also hoping to object to hearsay, and this is my concern. Ms. Love just said, I just want to ask about information he obtained about these other cases. And from my understanding of Mr. Sprinkle's report, he didn't firsthand work or make observations of anything. He just, my understanding is he read police reports or perhaps, like in the case of Quindarius Zachary, he was in the proffer session, but all that is hearsay.
He utilized information.
Okay, so I mean, you need to be careful about how you ask the question. So if the question is, you know, he already said I looked at other files. So what were those files? And then what did you do? Not what did you glean from those files or why did you care, but just the next step, okay?
Yes, sir.
All right, anybody, let's take our restroom break for the day, for the morning. We'll make it be the only one of the day and come back here and get the jury back.